Welcome to Sirius Stargazing. I'm TK, and in this episode, we're going to look at the globular cluster, Messier 15, M15 for short, in the constellation of Pegasus. Now, unlike open or galactic clusters, which populate the sweeping arms of spiral galaxies like the one we live in, globular clusters occupy the galactic halo, which is an enormous, almost spherical cloud of material around the Milky Way's core, an outer component of the galaxy, much fainter and less readily detectable than the bright nucleus or disk, which you and I are so familiar with. This is because, on average, it's very diffuse, but the globular clusters within it are, by contrast, incredibly dense, tightly bound, spherical ensembles of perhaps millions of suns. In the case of M15, the number is not quite this great, perhaps on the order of a few hundred thousand, but it is remarkable for having an unusually dense core. We know it has undergone a process called core collapse, and today many astronomers believe that deep in the center lurks a medium-sized black hole. Because of this, I always think of Messier 15 as a scale model of an elliptical galaxy, and when you see it, it really looks like one, but there are more subtle similarities as well. For example, as with elliptical galaxies, globular clusters like M15 are composed entirely of very ancient stars. Now, in the disk of the Milky Way, we see nebulae where stars are forming, and we see open clusters containing very young stars. But in globular clusters, no such star formation is going on anymore. In fact, so old are most of the stars in M15 that when they formed, there was actually no disk of the Milky Way at all. The galactic thin disk as we know it is a mere 9 billion years old or so, whereas members of M15 exceed 13 billion years, and that means they've been around for most of the history of the known universe. Find Pegasus on your star atlas or planisphere, and look for the star Enif, or Epsilon Pegasi, which marks the tip of its nose. Backtrack up its head, and it will bring you to the star Theta Pegasi, and you need to construct an imaginary line between these two. Continue this line back down in the direction Pegasus is facing, and past Enif for around half the distance between the two stars you've just found, and you'll come across M15. Knowing whether you've identified it for the first time can be tricky, so use this apparently nearby star as an indicator. It's brighter than the surrounding stars, and it will let you know that M15 is not far away. In poorer conditions, use averted vision to bring out more of the cluster, and with practice you should be able to see both the bright and dense core and the much fainter halo. At first, you might think that M15 looks just like a fuzzy star, but as a more experienced observer, you'll come to see it as being distinctly non-stellar, even at low magnification. Seeing M15 with a wide field of view, such as with binoculars, will really give you a good sense of scale. The cluster is about 200 light years wide, but at best will only appear as a small nebulous blob because it's an incredible 34,000 light years away, floating free from the galaxy's main spiral. Don't let its appearance disappoint you though. The trick to enjoying these deep sky objects is to know what it is you're looking at. And I find it amazing to consider that small blob for what it really is, the accumulated light of so many distant suns. It really leaves one wondering how the night sky would look to us if we lived there. Of course, there would be tens of thousands of bright stars above us, making our constellations either very numerous or at least very complicated. But because so many stars are bound together so very closely, a great number would be visible even during the day. So serious stargazers like us would never get any sleep. From a star system in M15, our home galaxy would be a truly staggering sight, dominating the sky, its beautiful spiral structure unmistakably clear. Maybe in the distant future, human beings will invent some kind of exotic new spacecraft and travel out of the galaxy to look back at our home. But for the foreseeable future at least, we can only study our neighboring star cities and try to infer how our own must appear to the rest of the universe. For now, we'll keep looking out from the inside. Until next time, clear skies.